Dear friends, in this presentation, we will discuss the science behind COVID-19 viral transmission. This is a continuation of our previous presentation on the same topic. In the previous presentation, we discussed what are the modes of COVID-19 viral transmission. And in this presentation, we will discuss when a patient who is infected with the COVID-19 virus can transmit the infection to others. So it's very important that we know when a person can transmit the virus. It is not only important that we know how the virus gets transmitted, but also it is essential that we should know that when a person with COVID-19 can infect others. And what we have found so far is it is generally related to the severity of the symptoms. The more severe the symptoms a patient has, the higher will be the rate of transmission from that particular patient. So this is what we know. We will see the science behind it in the subsequent slides. So what is called viral shedding? Viral shedding is nothing but a person infected with the COVID-19 virus can shed the virus in his respiratory droplets and other secretions. Generally, as of now, we detect virus in patients using RT-PCR, what you must have known, the throat swab. The swab is sent for a PCR examination. It is nothing but a polymerase chain reaction examination where we can identify the RNA particles of the virus. So this is called virus shedding. Generally, it is detected 1 to 3 days before the symptom onset. Maximum viral load is detected just around the day of the symptom. Suppose a patient has having fever on the third day after a contact, that is when he is going to shed maximum amount of virus, and that is when that particular patient is going to be highly contagious. And after the symptom onset, after the first day of symptom onset, gradually there is going to be a decline in the viral shedding. So this is what happens at the time of symptom onset. The viral shedding attains a peak and then it gradually declines over a period of time. So why does viral shedding declines over a period of time? Most of the patients develop antibodies to the virus 5 to 10 days after the symptom onset. When a patient gets infected, his body's immune system acts against the virus and develops antibodies. These antibodies will neutralize the virus, resulting in decline of the virus shedding. Thereby, the patient becomes non-infective. That is the reason why you must have seen several government's guidelines and World Health Organization guidelines that by the 10th day or 14 days after the onset of symptoms, if the patient is asymptomatic, the patient can be discharged from the observation and he can come back to work or go back into the society, because he has developed antibodies and he is no longer infective to others. The other thing that we have known now is viral shedding is dependent on disease severity, as I have already told. Suppose you have a patient who has florid symptoms, who has a very severe disease, he needs oxygen, he might even need ventilation. If these patients are going to shed the virus for a longer period of time, probably their immune response is less, so they are having a severe disease, and similarly they are going to shed the virus for a longer period of time. Generally, the viral shedding becomes undetectable 1 to 2 weeks after the first diagnosis in asymptomatic patients. In patients who have mild to moderate disease, by 3 weeks the viral shedding becomes undetectable. For severe patients, the viral shedding can occur for a much longer period of time. By viral shedding, what I mean is virus that is detected by a throat swab on a RT-PCR testing. So this is what I mean. And if the patient has severe disease, they are going to be infective for a longer period of time. Second thing that we have to understand is viral RNA is not a viable virus. We have discussed about this in our previous presentation also. As you all know, a virus will have the central element, which will be the ribonucleic acid or the RNA, which is covered by a protein shell, A virus that has both these elements, an RNA and a protein shell, is a replication competent virus, and that is only competent to infect another person. Now what we are doing by doing a throat swab is we are only detecting the RNA. We are not detecting the entire virus. We have tests which can diagnose the replication competent virus in a specimen, and those are viral cultures. So viral cultures are difficult to perform, and it is not widely available, and it is the only test that can identify a replication competent virus. Because it is difficult to perform and it is not being widely available, studies on viral culture are limited. So few available studies on viral culture on patients with COVID-19, we will see the results that viral culture has isolated viable virus even in asymptomatic individuals. So we have to realize that even asymptomatic individuals can shed the virus and can have a replication competent or an infection competent virus has been cultured using viral culture medium. And for patients who had mild to moderate infections, up to 8 to 9 days after the symptom onset, viral culture studies have cultured the viable virus. Similarly, in patients with severe infection, this duration of viral culture positivity is longer, as we have seen in the RNA studies. So we need to understand that even asymptomatic individuals had culturable viruses on viral culture testing. When can an infected person spread to others? It has been found that prolonged close contact with symptomatic patients is essential for an infection spread from one person to another. This primarily happens through a respiratory droplet infection with a closed contact. Chinese studies have found that up to 75% to 85% of cluster of cases happened in a household setting. By that, what we mean is one person gets infected and majority of the other infections that we see is from his own household members. So up to 75% to 85% of patients are the cluster of cases happened in a household setting. Similarly, in a Korean study also, 9 out of 13 secondary cases came out of a household setting. Can a person get infected outside of a household setting? Yes, they can get infected. What we need is a prolonged close contact. It is not that just by seeing a patient for 2 minutes, exchanging a few words with him, however maintaining a social distance of up to 1 to 2 meters, you are not going to get the virus. Prolonged close contact is essential for getting the virus, and that has been defined as approximately as up to 1 hour. You should have a prolonged and close contact for more than 1 hour with a symptomatic patient for getting the virus infected. So this is what we need to understand, that just by seeing the patient, just by talking to the patient, by standing at a social distance of 1 to 2 meter, the risk of transmission is very less. So knowing this will help in reducing the stigma associated with COVID-19 patient, that you should not even see the patient, you should not even talk to the patient. No, that should not happen. If you maintain a safe distance, if you have a mask on your face, and you have all the strategies to prevent a droplet from the patient settling on the others, then the risk of transmission is very less. Outside of a household setting, situations like sharing meals, an enclosed workspace, gyms and places of worship provide opportunities for a prolonged and a close contact. That is when this infection can transmit in a community setting. So now we will discuss what is happening regarding transmission from asymptomatic individual. Now we need to identify two distinct terminologies here. One is asymptomatic transmission, the other is pre-symptomatic transmission. Some individuals infected with COVID-19 never develop symptoms due to the virus. This type of transmission is called asymptomatic transmission. Now, Some patients start shedding the virus few days before the symptom onset. This category is called pre-symptomatic transmission. We will see in the subsequent slides the science behind asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic transmission. We should know this to develop public health strategies and various measures to limit transmission from one person to other. Because in general, a patient who has symptoms like fever, respiratory symptoms are isolated. They are sent to a fever clinic. Suppose a patient comes or gets inside an airport, he is screened with a thermal scanner. If they have fever, then he will be isolated. That particular patient will be isolated. So a patient who has symptoms will be isolated so that the transmission from that particular patient will be limited. However, when it comes to asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic transmission, we have no ways to identify whether that particular patient carries a virus or sheds the virus. So this has an enormous public health strategic implication, and we need to know what is the scientific data that is existing. Asymptomatic transmission is a marker of the burden of disease in the community, and it is also a marker of transmission potential of the virus. For example, asymptomatic transmission rate is 8% for measles and 95% for polio virus. That means majority of patients who have measles are symptomatic, whereas majority of patients who have polio are asymptomatic, but they still continue to shed the virus and infect others. Now, the picture on the right side shows the average number of people infected by an individual. It is very high for measles. For example, if you see, the number is 12 to 18. A patient having measles can infect up to 12 to 18 individuals, while a patient having polio can infect 5 to 7 individuals. This shows that many poliovirus infections are asymptomatic, and a person with polio can infect 5 to 7 individuals, while many measles virus infections are symptomatic and it is also highly contagious. A child with measles can infect up to 12 to 18 children. So this is what this data shows us. So what it comes to COVID-19 virus, the number is 1.4 to 2.5. A patient with COVID-19 virus can infect up to two individuals in his vicinity. So this is the data that we had as of January 2020. Early studies from the US and the China found that many patients were asymptomatic and could transmit the virus. So there was a big fear in the early part of this year that many are asymptomatic and they are going to spread the disease to others, and we never know who is going to become symptomatic. So this was the impression from the earlier studies. However, the follow-up of these studies found that many patients who were asymptomatic were asymptomatic at the time of testing. Subsequently, they went on to develop symptoms. So up to 75 to 100% of patients developed symptoms subsequently. So now what we know, that majority of patients will develop symptoms. Truly asymptomatic patients are very less. So recent data that has accumulated in the past few weeks have shown that only less than 1/4 of patients are truly asymptomatic. Majority of the patients go on to develop symptomatic COVID-19 infection. Can asymptomatic patients, can they cause large outbreaks? Can they be a source for a large outbreak? Generally, the risk is less, because even though viral loads can be equivalent to symptomatic patients, previously we have shown that virus has been cultured from asymptomatic individuals. Viral loads can be equivalent. However, most asymptomatic patients who had close contact with actual patients, they are more likely to be isolated. So this is very, very essential when it comes to the government's initiative in laying down the isolation measures and strictly following the isolation measures from the personal point of view. Because even if a contact of a patient with COVID-19, even if they are asymptomatic, they have to remain in isolation or remain in quarantine because they can still infect others. Second, the proportion of asymptomatic patient is very small. It is less than 1/4. So these are the reason why generally asymptomatic carriers cannot cause large outbreaks, because the proportion is less and more likely they are going to be isolated in a country where the strict isolation practices are followed. Coming on to pre-symptomatic transmission, as we have already seen, virus shedding happens even before the onset of symptoms, up to 1 to 3 days before the onset of symptoms. Real-time studies and experimental studies have found that from 6 to 44% of transmission can occur from pre-symptomatic individuals. So this is also a significant number, that pre-symptomatic transmission can also happen. Now, what is the bottom line of all this research data that has accumulated in the past 4 or 5 months? Now, we have 4 studies which is also given out in the World Health Organization manuscript on transmission of COVID-19 virus, that they have found that 0.8 to 15% of transmission happens from symptomatic individuals. Only up to 0.2 to 2% happens from asymptomatic individuals. So generally, transmission from asymptomatic individuals is very less. We don't have to really fear this particular type of transmission. And from symptomatic individuals, the transmission is from up to 15%. That is why we need to screen the patients for symptoms, and patients with symptom need to be isolated. So to conclude, COVID-19 patients who have symptoms are the most important source of infection. Symptomatic COVID-19 patients are the most important source of infection. Pre-symptomatic transmission can occur. Hence, we should always follow safety precautions like mask and maintaining a social distance. So that is always needed. It is not that only from a symptomatic COVID-19 patient you should be following the precautions. It should be almost universal during the time of pandemic. Asymptomatic transmission cannot be ruled out. Hence, extensive testing and isolating the contacts of a COVID-19 patient is essential. So majority of COVID-19 transmission occurs from pre-symptomatic individuals. So we need to take all the measures of symptom screening, testing and isolating them. Pre-symptomatic and asymptomatic transmission can still occur, as laid out by the recent World Health Organization document. Hence, we should follow universal safety precautions. Thank you, dear friends. Kindly subscribe to our YouTube channel. Hope you find this useful. Thank you, dear friends.